people knew about him. And when you write Seven Story Mountain and have the kind of friends he had and were the New York Village, Greenwich Village sophisticate who does this ridiculous thing, goes to a monastery and stays there. You know, he doesn't go on a lark. He doesn't go after a Maharishi for a few weeks. He goes and spends his life there.
Thomas Merton, writer, poet, traveler, came to these Kentucky hills to visit the Trappist monastery here during the first years of the Second World War. He stayed to become a monk here at the Monastery of Gethsemane. Behind these abbey walls, he fully expected to live the kind of life most of us think of when we read of monks in monasteries. Bells ring, devout troops of hooded and mysterious figures lay down their hoes and scythes to pray. The only sound that is ever heard are voices in prayer or the plain music of the Gregorian chant, a simple and romantic life. Into this traditional monastic landscape comes something strange. A photographer in a habit? A monk on the run, Thomas Merton. In his interests and in his writings, he crossed the usual boundaries of religion. He was understood in the East as well as in the West. He was a monk, but an unusual one. He was an activist involved in the peace movement and civil rights. We tend to think of monks as people in retreat from the world, involved only in solitude and contemplation. Thomas Merton changed all that. Hello, I'm Roy Bonesteel. This is Man Alive.
The monk is somebody who says, in one way or other, that the claims of the world are fraudulent. Now, this, of course, is a dreadful thing to say, and especially it's being said on TV. But nevertheless, there is something essentially valid in this kind of claim. This puts the monk on the same plane with the Marxist, because the Marxist directs a dialectical critique of social structures toward the end of revolutionary change. The difference between the monk and the Marxist is fundamental insofar as the Marxist's view of change is oriented to the change of substructures, economic substructures, and the monk is seeking to change man's consciousness.
In the spring of 78 and the 10th anniversary of his death, young people and old, Catholics, Protestants, Jews and Hindus, met to remember him in Vancouver. I wondered about the qualities of this man that attracted such an assortment of people.
There aren't that many young people here at the conference, but there are some. You are one of them. What is it that Thomas Merton did or says that attracts young people?
Well, I think the thing that attracts young people as well as old people, elderly people, I should say, is his blending of action and spirituality. The two aren't seen by him as being separate.
C'est un homme qui avait une crise d'identité permanente. Et nous espérons que nos étudiants et des crises d'identité ou qu'ils soient conscients des changements d'identité, autrement à quoi sert l'éducation? C'est une sorte de questionnement de tout. Ça pourrait ou ça devrait être ça devrait mettre tout en question l'éducation laïque autant que religieuse.
On the last day of January 1915, under the sign of the Water Bearer, in the year of a great war, and down in the shadow of some French mountains on the borders of Spain, I came into the world. His mother, an American, died when he was six. His father, a New Zealand landscape painter successful in his time, died when Merton was only 15. He spent his childhood at various times in southern France, the US, Bermuda, and Great Britain. University at Cambridge, and then Columbia. A confused and unhappy time. At 26, he saw his life as a fractured mess. His poetry shows a fascination with the symbol of the window, separating the viewer from reality, yet defining it. Merton determined to step through this symbolic window to pursue the reality he saw there for himself, his obsession, a religious and more spiritual life. He found a new symbol, the tower, place of retreat from the world, Gethsemane. But he is still pursued by old shadows. He wrote, "This double, this writer who has followed me into the cloister, I cannot lose him. He still wears the name of Thomas Merton. And the worst of it, he has my superiors on his side. They won't kick him out."
The period of monastic formation is a period of cure, of convalescence. And then when one makes one's profession, one has passed through convalescence and is ready to begin to be educated in a new way, the education of the new man.
The cure included the purgative experience of writing his autobiography, The Seven Story Mountain, a bestseller. And it brought his shadow, Merton the writer, firmly into the monastery alongside Merton as Father Lewis, the priest.
I think Merton was always interested in the world and in being active in the world. As a young man, he was interested in Dorothy Day and what that would be. He wanted to be a Franciscan in poverty and in the world and that sort of thing. And when he went to the monastery, I think what he had to do was to prepare himself somehow to take up a role in that world in a way. And what prepared him, oddly, paradoxically, was contemplative life.
By the early 50s, Merton, or Father Lewis, had already written several books, was novice master with a heavy teaching load, plus carrying on a kind of ministry by correspondence.
La première fois que j'ai entendu parler de Père Merton, c'était quand j'étais jeune moine dans l'Argentine, moine bénédictin, et j'ai lu son livre, The Seven Story Mountain, en espagnol, et j'avais dit, sa vie, c'est pour moi. Et j'ai été à États-Unis, à la Baie de Gethsemane, comme novice. J'ai passé deux ans dans le noviciat, et dans ma seconde année de noviciat, on m'a dit, vous serez secrétaire pour Père Louis.
What sort of a man was he to work for? What was he like personally?
If he was working seriously at his work, he didn't like interruptions or people coming in with stupid questions. I mean, but if he was quite impish, in his attitude outside, he liked to joke a lot.
Do you personally think he moved away from Christianity when he was getting into the Eastern religion as much as he was?
No, I don't think so. He saw it sort of as a bridge between both East and West, that modern man and the Western civilization needed a lot that the East had to give, especially when it came to techniques of contemplation or meditation. Pacifying one's passions, learning to be still and listen.
Merton tried to escape into the quiet of the Abbey woodlands as often as he could, longing for the hermit's existence he had hoped to find, but bound by his abbot's wish that he continue writing, and his own inclinations, which compelled him to follow his curiosity with his pen. When we are alone on a starlit night, when by chance we see the migrating birds in autumn descending on a grove to rest and eat, at such times the awakening, the turning inside out of all values, the newness, provides a glimpse of the cosmic dance.
Both Christianity and Buddhism agree that the root of man's problems is that his consciousness is all fouled up, and that he does not apprehend reality as it fully and really is. That the moment he looks at something, he begins to interpret it in ways which are prejudiced and predetermined to fit a certain wrong picture of the world in which he is, as an individual ego, in the center of things. This is called by Buddhism avidya, or ignorance.
The mid-60s, rockets blasting to the moon, a war going on in Vietnam. Merton was by now part-time in a hermitage built for him deep in the woodlands of the Abbey grounds. With more time for reflection, he conducted an intensified campaign of letters, articles, and more than 50 books commenting on the society swirling beyond the Abbey gates. On my 46th birthday, they put an ape into space. They recovered him alive. He was bothered by no metaphysical problems. I am 46 years old. Civilization has deigned to grace my 46th birthday with this marvelous feat. Let me learn from this contented ape. He pressed buttons, he pulled levers. They shot him too far, never mind. They fished him out of the Atlantic and he shook hands with the Navy. What sort of a man was he? What came across to you about Thomas Merton?
Fun.
Is that right?
Yes. He was a very talented writer, a real writer who knows that they can write, not full of false humility, which is boring, you know. He didn't have to be bolstered up about his writing. Maybe there were other areas that he needed bolstering, but writing, no. I mean, his manuscripts needed practically no editing, as far as I was concerned.
Merton, however, felt the necessity to defend his writing. He said, if the Catholic Church is turning to the modern world, then it becomes necessary for at least a few contemplative and monastic theologians to contribute something of their own to the discussion.
But you can see the burgeoning critic and much more active critic coming out. He conjectures of a guilty bystander, which is a kind of late work, 64, I think. He really is feeling a little guilty, he says, that he's been silent.
But he wasn't all that silent. He writes, I am told by a high superior, it is not your place to write about nuclear war. That is for bishops. An interesting thing about Merton is that he wrote about nuclear war, about civil rights, about peace, in a manner that won him the respect of activists and theoreticians alike. All the while, his personal experience was mostly made up of things of nature. Raindrops tumbling from ferns into quiet ponds, the ever-changing colors of trees around his hermitage.
His humor was a big part of him, wasn't it?
Oh, yes. He was such a funny guy. I think there's so much of his dry wit that I get a little sad sometimes when people are very, very serious, you know, about the whole thing, because he was able to laugh at himself.
And to laugh with his friends, too, some of whom had taken to slipping up a side road to the hermitage for the occasional afternoon picnic with the hermit.
What his work is doing, it's giving people who are activists a base and a feeling that this great man had these insights and thoughts, as well as providing them with a spiritual underbase, which is a necessity for activism.
Merton said Western industrial culture has simultaneously reached the climax of rationality and complete absurdity. The thing about Zen is that it pushes contradictions to their ultimate limit, where one has to choose between madness and innocence. And Zen suggests that society may be heading toward one or the other on a cosmic scale, because one way or the other, as madmen or innocents, we are already there. It might be good to open our eyes and see.
Significant choices are no longer able to be made in the kind of organized society that you have, either under capitalism or under Soviet socialism. The choices that are really important have all been made before you get around to trying it yourself. And I would say that on this particular point, which is very important indeed in the early Marx, you have a basically Christian idea. Christianity is against alienation. Christianity revolts against an alienated life.
His writing, I guess he called them letters to a white liberal. He even speaks very favorably of the Black Power movement that was developing at that time, even with its violence connotations and overtones. He felt that the problem was with the whites, not with the blacks, and that was a message he had to give.
You feel then that Merton rather answers the question about what one person can do to help in a very complex society?
Yes, in a way that, you know, a totally unexpected source of opposition comes out of a Trappist monastery. The point of one person changing society, I think, is all too often overlooked in our days when we think we have to have big organizations and big demonstrations for that part.
What were the Cold War letters? Tell me about them. Who were they to?
He circulated a gathering of letters that he had written, which didn't deal only with war, dealt with all sorts of social issues, again, racism and all this. They were to prominent people, and also small people. And in that, he was sort of carrying on a special ministry of social concern that was again, astonishing for someone who supposedly was behind monastery walls and working away in the monastery garden and something like that, reaching people, many people of influence.
One of the gardens Merton was cultivating was his Zen garden and his studies of Eastern cultures and religions. Out of this came experiments with different forms of expression. One of these was the development of purposefully non-meaningful drawing, a kind of calligraphy. In a world cluttered and programmed with an infinity of practical signs and consequential digits referring to business, law, government, and war, one who makes such nondescript marks as these is conscious of a special vocation to be inconsequential, to be firmly alien to the program. His interest in the East would finally draw him there. The opportunity came in the fall of 1968. But he was invited to Bangkok to give an address to a conference of all Asian monastic leaders. This was an experience which Merton was eager for. Personal discussions with Buddhist and Hindu scholars, the chance to further his own vocation as a monk. It was to be only his second major trip outside the walls of Gethsemane in 27 years.
The life of many monks and many dedicated women and many dedicated people is a life of total alienation. In the sense that it is a legal surrender of things which perhaps they should not have surrendered, and a failure to fulfill potentialities which the monastery should allow them to fulfill.
His first stop was Bangkok. He would return for the Bangkok conference after several weeks in India and Ceylon. But first, his plans were to travel to the north of India for the meeting he was looking forward to with the Dalai Lama in the foothills of the Himalayas. A friend he met in India at this time was Amaya Chakravarti, a Hindu scholar.
Doctor, you were with Thomas Merton in India.
Yes, I traveled with him in Calcutta and in different places and found that he was immediately acceptable to the Indian people because he was not only a sage but a saint.
How about his philosophy in terms of the Eastern faith, Hindu?
He had already studied a lot of Buddhism and Hinduism and Zen, but in India he acquainted himself more deeply with those traditions. He had seen the Dalai Lama, the ex-king and religious head of Tibet, and had very deep and noble conversations with him as to the meaning of silence and prayer.
Merton's diary. We drove up earlier at 8:30, a bright, clear morning. More people and more trucks on the road. Army trucks roaring around the corners. I like the solidity of the Dalai Lama's ideas. He is a very consecutive thinker and moves from step to step. His ideas of the interior life are built on very solid foundations and on a real awareness of practical problems. He insists on detachment, on an unworldly life, yet sees it as a way to complete understanding of and participation in the problems of life.
What was there about Merton that made him able to transcend religious barriers like that?
Well, it's very hard to know. It's something of an illumination that comes to people through their own experiential life, through their deep probings into the meaning of humanity. And in his case, through the deep personal goodness which brought him to a worldwide audience and a sympathy for people's compassion, understanding, and a sense that we all belong together.
There has been some concern expressed that Merton was drifting toward Eastern religion. Does the fact that he embraced Eastern faith make him any less a Christian?
No. I should say I had discussions on that with him. He was a very devout Christian mystic, a Trappist. He said, I'm going back home pretty soon to Gethsemane. But that did not exclude affinities with other true traditions and new manifestations of the divinity in man. So he made a very powerful kind of connection between the traditional and the emergence of a new factor in human life, but without parting with what he had, but adding to it from the resources of the spirit to the acquaintanceship with different cultures and people. He remained true to his own tradition.
After his visit with the Dalai Lama, and just before setting off to southern India in Bangkok, Merton had the opportunity to be by himself for a few days at a tea estate high in the mountains near Darjeeling. It was a time for regaining balance and to reconsider what he had learned. He writes in his last journal, I'm glad I came here. All morning alone on the mountainside in the warm sun now overclouded. Plenty of time to think. I have a definite feeling it was a waste of time, something I didn't need to do. However, if I have discovered I didn't need to do it, it has not been a waste of time. It was also a time to remember the roots of his Trappist order, to get strength from his Christian traditions, and to plan for the future. Merton felt the need to live a more solitary hermit's life, which had eluded him at Gethsemane. His idea was to set up a remote hermitage for the order, maybe in Alaska. He said, I do not think I ought to separate myself completely from Gethsemane. I suppose I ought to end my days there. Bangkok. The final leg of the journey, Merton would be back in Gethsemane to stay sooner than he anticipated.
Alors, donc ça a créé une espèce de méfiance envers le bouddhisme, n'est-ce pas? Alors c'est une chose du passé. Il ne faut plus juger le bouddhisme d'après ce qui est secondaire et bas, mais au contraire, d'y trouver ce qui est le plus riche et le plus valable pour nous. Alors ça, c'est par exemple dans le zen et dans ce qu'il y a de plus avancé dans la méditation.
Merton was very publicity shy. This was the only film the media ever took of him, the Bangkok Conference.
If you forget everything else that has been said, I would suggest you remember this for the future. From now on, everybody stands on his own feet. This, I think, is what Buddhism is about, it's what Christianity is about, what monasticism is about, if you understand it in terms of grace. That is to say, it's not a Pelagian statement by any means, but it is a statement to the effect that we can no longer rely on being supported by structures which may be destroyed at any moment by a political power, a political force. You cannot rely on structures. The time for relying on structures has disappeared. They're good and they should help us and we should do the best we can with them. But they may be taken away. And if everything is taken away, what do you do next? I think, by way of closing, that this kind of view of reality is essentially very close to the Christian monastic view of reality. It is the view that if you once penetrate by detachment and purity of heart to the inner secret of the ground of one's ordinary experience, you attain to a liberty which nobody can touch, which nobody can affect, which no political change of circumstances can do anything to. I admit this is a little bit idealistic. I have not attempted to see how this works in a concentration camp, and I hope I don't have the opportunity. But I'm just saying that somewhere behind our monasticism and behind Buddhist monasticism is the belief that this kind of freedom and transcendence are somehow attainable. So I will conclude on that note. I believe the plan is to have all the questions for this morning's conferences this evening at the panel. So I will disappear from view and we can all have a Coke or something. Thank you very much.
This was the last time anyone saw Thomas Merton alive. 2 hours after his speech, he was accidentally electrocuted in his room when he touched a faulty electric fan. Just before he died, he wrote to friends, "Our real journey in life is interior. It's a matter of growth and of an ever greater surrender to the creative action of love and grace in our hearts." The enthusiastic action of the 60s led to the crises and consequences of the 70s. As a result, we may appreciate more Merton's emphasis on spiritual growth, not just for individuals, but for societies. As for Thomas Merton, his ideas live on in his books and in his friends. His body lies buried in the little monk's graveyard by the side of the Abbey Church. The monk on the run, still, at last. Anyone who knew him would find that hard to believe. Next week, Politics and the Pope, a program about the Pope, Poland, and the political implications of his election.
In your great kindness, you have looked down on our brother, and you have taken him to enjoy the vision of your beauty. Give us grace, Lord God, Master of the universe. And you, O Brother Thomas, you who are now so close to God, you who see him as he really is, oh, if you please, let us share in something of that beauty which you now contemplate forever.
Pearl Harbor. It's such a beautiful name, isn't it?
good for a poem. Pearl Harbor. Oh, such devastation. War, it's a horrible business. War, again, in my lifetime. Seems so long already. And now the journey to Gethsemane. The whole world is in its own Gethsemane now, with the agony of another war, with the blood and the pain and the sweat of death, with the cold feeling that disaster is near, it's unavoidable, the end is imminent, and the only choice you've got is how you accept it. My journey to Gethsemane is different. Gethsemane, for me, is not a garden, but an abbey. It's not agony, but healing. Not anguish, but home, paradise, Pearl Harbor, safety, peace, the pearl of great price, the harbor of tranquility. Oh, I want this for the whole world. Is it wrong for me to have this when the whole world is without joy? Well, there's not much joy in this train station. All the symbols of loneliness are here, alone, freezing rain, darkness, trains. I like the way Thomas Wolfe writes of trains. See, they're metaphors for the solitary human journey. Hurried flight across the landscape of the earth, a whistle wailing in the fearful blackness, and the flutter of lights and then emptiness and echoes. Trains are haunting engines of loss and absence. Boy, there's so much poetry in me tonight. I guess I'm excited, huh? That makes the words, well, makes the words. Boy. And she be surprised. I wonder why I think of her now when I'm further than ever from what her world embraced. There was a war then also. I don't remember it, of course. We were in France, and I was born to two hapless artists, and France was not a good place to be during the Great War. That's how Hemingway would say it, and it's not a good place. So, she was right about us getting out of there. That's one time I have to admit she was right. She had to carry me out of France. She had to hold me. I was too young to walk. She had to hold me then. And carry me out of France through clusters of U-boats and clouds of fear into New York Harbor and destiny. I'd be free of her in New York, at least for a while. You know, it's funny how I keep moving east, from France to New York to Kentucky, well, or is that west? Have to go west, get the east, at least I do. Pearl Harbor's in the Pacific, right? I guess I'll never see the Pacific. Gethsemane be as close as I get. You hear that? My train. It's my last train ride. Whoa! No more travel, no more journeys, huh? Gotta get off the damn road. I'll be in Gethsemane for the rest of my life. The rest of my life. That's what I need. I need rest. I need to stop running. Well, I'll never see New York again. Well, that's just as well. You see, so much happened here. I was brought up here, baptized here, graduated Columbia here. Began my career as a professor. I learned to be tough here and tender and wrote poems and a dissertation. We buried her here. I wrote novels here. And I got sick of sex here. It's not a good place anymore. And so I leave it. Is this seat vacant? Huh?
Yeah, thanks. Well, I won't get into much of a conversation with this fellow. Well, that's just as well. I mean, you know, no friendly reminders of New York. Besides, I got too much going on in my own mind and don't feel like talking. Besides, monks, you know, they look better with their mouths shut. At least Trappists do. That is a funny name for a monastery, isn't it? Where you're supposed to keep quiet. Trappist. Keep your trap shut, Trappist. Don't get trapped. I like their official name better, Cistercian. It sounds elegant and mysterious and aloof. Boy, how am I gonna do not talking forever? I'm such a good talker. You give me a drink, I'll talk you into anything. Well, that's how they'll keep me quiet, no liquor. Well, I could use a drink right now. Sitting next to this fellow, he's the one that they ought to shut up for good. No one would miss him. Who's gonna miss me, huh? Maggie? I hope. Is that wrong? How am I gonna make a monk? It's crazy. I'm Tom Merton, man of the world. Tom Merton, who drank half the world under the table and chased the better half around the globe. All that alcohol and all that sex, it won't, you know, won't mix easily with holy water and fasting. Coffee? Yeah, black, please. Thanks. Well, I hope it's different this time. I've had too many dreams shattered to handle any more hope. Well, I mean, the whole country's having a dream shattered now, Pearl Harbor. Death came so quickly, a lot of people were burned. Now, that must be the worst kind of death. You expect the next moment's going to be as normal as the last, and death walks in, and it's all over. Must be sad to die in December, too, near Christmas. Tough to burn to death. Oh, I don't know. How am I gonna make a monk? I mean, yeah, monks, they're supposed to handle death easily. I don't know if I can. I know that she didn't. I was only six when she died, and she made such a damn mess of it. Boy. She didn't even say goodbye. She wouldn't let me near her. She was always that way, but I thought if she were dying, it'd be different, but it wasn't. My father came home from the hospital with that sad look on his face. He loved her a lot. He was the best thing that ever happened to her, or to me, for that matter. He painted such bright scenes all during the war. They were full of sunshine and full of color. He made me believe in light. I'm glad I didn't get his name, Owen. It's a lot harder to live with than Thomas. She hated Thomas. I mean, it had to be Tom. Even on the birth certificate, Tom. In the middle of all that French. What? My thoughts are all over the lot, huh? Funny kind of feeling. It's like dying. Going to Gethsemane. It's a death to the world and to the self, a death to hard liquor and soft women. I don't mind that kind of dying. Well, at least tonight I don't, because I feel I'm beginning now. I'm eager and I'm happy and looking forward and... I never had a home or a family to speak of, so I feel like an orphan that's been adopted for the first time and is going to get a home and a family now. And... Yes, of course I intend to pay. I just thought I was in my own thoughts. I didn't see you standing there. I've got the ticket here somewhere. Just give me a chance to look for it. So... Well, maybe you ought to come back in a minute and... Oh, wait a minute. Here, I've... Yeah, here it is. Okay. Okay. He gave me a letter when he came into the house. My father, he gave me a letter with a lot of tears and emotion in his eyes. I was only six, and he gave me a letter. The strangest letter I ever got in my life, the saddest, the worst. I wish I'd never gotten it. Why did she write? Well, I took this letter, and my father told me that I better go off and read it alone somewhere. Wish he had had his arm around me when I read it. I'd never received a letter from my mother before. You know, and I recognized the handwriting, and I was good at reading, but that was printing and books. So this was hard to read. It was slow and painful, and I became confused, and... began to shiver, and I couldn't grasp all of it. My mother, she's informing me by mail that she's never going to see me again. She's telling me she's going to die and that this is her goodbye to me. And I knew she was sick. She was very sick, but death is something you somehow never expect. So I began to cry, and I became depressed, of course, and it was... There's such a heavy sorrow. I mean, I can feel it now when I think about it, and it's not just because she was dying. It's because she didn't care enough to want to see me, that she didn't care enough to want to touch me and talk to me of love and of meaning and missing, and that she didn't let me cry in her arms. I've cried in the arms of more women than I can number since then, and it's had less to do with sex than with touching, and less a sign of strength than a need to be cared for. I guess all this will come back to haunt me in the monastery, huh? Well, maybe if they let me write, you know, my readers will care for me. Well, I mean, who wants to read the books of a monk? I want to be a writer. I want to be the best damn writer monastic life has ever seen. And I want everybody to know Tom Merton and prove to her that she was wrong. To have demanded so much and given so little, and to prove to her that I was better than she thought. I know I can get petty. I'm still having temper tantrums, but... Why did she write when she could have held me? My autobiography, The Seven-Story Mountain. It hit the top of the charts, as they say. It made it. The reviews are great. The New York Times loved it. It's on the bestseller list. And some people say that Thomas Merton is a, they say that he is. Evelyn Waugh loved it. You know, I've been in the monastery 7 years. Now, monks are not supposed to be so popular or so vain or so, I am happy all this has happened, obviously, but I'm a little frightened, too. There's something destructive about all this. You see, the other day, some of the younger monks, they asked me how I would complete the sentence, I am. It's some kind of psychological test. You know. So, you know what I said? I said, I am Thomas Merton, the famous writer. There was a long, embarrassed silence after that. They were confused, and I was revealed in a way that was awkward. See, I didn't think of using my religious name, Lewis. They were all shocked. Well, you see, I still think of myself as Thomas Merton, the guy who rang the bell here 7 years ago and asked to be let in, but the guy who writes books under his own name without writing books anonymously or under a religious name. So, Thomas Merton, a famous writer, imagine, not Thomas Merton the monk or the contemplative. Now, I hate to admit this, and I'd never tell the abbot, but I'd rather be a writer than a monk. I'm still devoted to the monastery, but it'd all die without the writing because I'm a better writer than I am a monk. It's because I'd prefer to be. But how do I live with all this? How do I make the native talent more important than the chosen way of life? How do I call myself a contemplative when I want books more than I want grace? This terrible need to be honest with myself, it sickens me. I don't like what I see, but I'm forced to look. I won't lie to myself, even for pious reasons. Now, is that arrogance or is that humility? There's so many contradictions, there's circles and circles and circles. So, I'm ill at ease with myself. But you know, the trouble with a lot of people around here is that they try to keep me from becoming what I'm supposed to be. I mean, the abbot does, most of my readers do. They want a monk who's very monkish. They want monkey business. That's what they want, a performance. Well, I won't perform. It's not the schedule or the prayers or the fasting or the celibacy or whatever that makes a good monk. It's what you do with who you are that makes you good. And I will not be good on schedule. I won't perform in a monastic circus for an audience that looks in on my life but doesn't really want to know the inner me, the guy God gave a vocation to, a vocation to be himself. See, now, that's why my mother didn't like me. She was my first abbot. You know, I wouldn't jump through the hoop for her. Well, I'm not a seal. I'm a human being. I'm a writer. I'm Thomas Merton, the famous writer, and I'm not going to apologize for it. Except to myself. I guess I'm defending myself, huh? Well, someone's got to defend me. Here I am, I'm talking to myself. I'm trying to make certain that I hear what I'm trying to say to others, but I like the attention writing brings me, but something else is going on. It sounds self-serving, I know when I say it, but something else is going on when I write. I touch God. I find the inner me, the true self, the guy who was here before he became a monk, the person behind the mask, the truth beneath the disguise, the light beyond the shadow. Well, does that make me a heretic? I'm trying to do something for myself and others that needs to be done. I'm saying that holiness has something to do with passion. Maybe some of the men in this monastery are further from God than a lot of people in the world. God can't be that easily manipulated to perform the way we want God to perform by whatever monastic schedule or rules that we devise. It's what you become passionate about and die for, what you become involved in and suffer for, what you rejoice in with all your being. That's what matters, how you live. I write and it purifies my soul. I write and I feel unworthy of what I've written. I write and I live. And I feel it's okay for me to be a monk. Now, the book, that's selling. Its mail is monumental. And it's my life that they're reading about. And they're reading about a monk who left the secular world because it did not have enough passion in it, but a contemplative who will not let the monastery kill his emotion, his desire to be himself. Luther was a monk. Maybe I'm supposed to go the same way. I don't know. You know, I'm angry about the exploitation of Negroes, but no one cares. I'm sick about the monster that we exploded on Hiroshima. No one cares, as these things, they make us secure. Well, one thing I learned as a contemplative is that you can count on nothing. You don't control the process. When you do, that's when you're in trouble. Control. See, that's what's behind the hell of Harlem and the horror of Hiroshima. Control. Another race with power or with prejudice or with a bomb against which there is no defense. Now, if I let them control me, I become involved in the syndrome of control that sickens us. If I give in, they begin to think that human lives are predictable and that human beings ought to conform. Well, one way to keep control out of their hands is to write an autobiography that makes everyone responsible for your life. Now, when everyone is involved in your life, then no one controls it. I am going to become a saint, but in a way that doesn't fit the rules. So, here I am. I'm 7 years in a monastery, and already I'm a worldly monk. And if I'm good at what I'm supposed to be, I'll make it as a monk. If I have to give up what I'm meant to be, it won't matter what kind of monk I was. Oh, yes, I would like some more tea. Thank you. No, the trip was not very difficult. It wasn't very difficult because of the expectation and the memories. This is the first time I've been here since I left for Gethsemane so many years ago. It was 22 years ago that I left for Kentucky. Yes, I have changed a great deal. But the trip here was a joy. As the plane circled New York City, I kept saying to myself, I'm home, I'm home. No, I don't know what that all means, because I left here looking for home and I found it in the monastery, but maybe both places are home, and I have to get the two together before I'm really safe, getting opposites together. Yes, that's what I need in my life. You see, you're a Buddhist, and I'm a Christian. You're Dr. Suzuki, the famous scholar from the East. And I'm Thomas Merton, a writer from the West. And I'd like to know why I find a compatibility between things that my church tells me I should find incompatible. And do I find this because I'm arrogant, or because I'm spiritual, because I'm narrow, because I have a vision, because... Yes, I feel like I'm going to confession to a Buddhist. I went to Gethsemane hoping to find freedom and simplicity, and now I'm a little narrow and confined. So, part of the reason why I'm here is because I went there, so the road I've taken hasn't been the wrong one. I agree with you. There are no wrong roads. I used to think there one. Well, I thought that that the whole world was a wrong road, and most of the people were misdirected. But now I see that God is an inner gyroscope in each life, as a kind of inner compass that guides the human heart safely. I once thought that God and the spiritual life were for a few people, you know? Monastic life, that's for heroes and for saints, for celibates and cloistered clerics, for nobody, you see? You see, that's what made it so appealing. I was doing what nobody else was doing. I was reckless and wild and grand and special and free and... oh, yes, thank you. I was in Louisville a couple of years ago, and it's a city not far from my monastery, and there were a lot of people in the street, and I suddenly felt an overwhelming sense of oneness with them. And it was the most profound religious experience of my monastic life, and it happened outside the monastery. I kept saying to myself, I'm like them and they're like me, and I don't want to be different and I don't want to be better. You know, I was shattered to the depths by that experience, because what was I doing as a monk if it made no difference? And then I thought to myself, well, people don't get married to be different, and they don't enter professions to be different. They do what they do because it has importance in itself, whether or not it's any different or any better than what anyone else is doing. My church does not understand enough about the ordinary for me to learn what I need to know there. I don't want to be a Buddhist, but I do need to be a man, and I need to be assured that the human dimension in all of us is worthy, and that grace is God's gift to those who never suspect that they're different. I can't learn all I need to know from Buddhism, but between Buddhism and Christianity, I think I can learn what I need to know for the next step in the journey. Yes, I am confused. But I also feel I've been enlightened. My journey goes on, and I'll get lost if I go off the road, so I'll be searching until I die. I know you Buddhists don't find that surprising, but we in the West, we think that monks ought to be settled. I wish that you could come to our monastery and talk to our monks, but I'm afraid that's not possible. But one day we shall learn that God made none of us very different. So the divisions and the conflicts are never justified. not the truth that separates. It's blindness and pride and the fear of knowing how much alike we are. Okay, can I get a rug in here? Well, I'm not asking for luxury. It's only a cinder block hideaway. But I've brought enough money into the monastery, you think, that they could afford a carpet? Roger, they gave you a hard time, huh? I figured as much. Well, you tell them for me that when I visit the monastery, that I won't sit. And that'll make up for the chair I took. I've wanted a place like this for longer than I can remember. But if someone had told me when I was a student at Columbia that I'd be a hermit someday, I would have thought them as weird as some people think I am now. But a lot of those same people, you know, they just dream of getting away. And they'd find monastic life attractive. A lot of them would like to have written books and walked out on the whole damn world. But, you see, I'm not really going to do it quite that way. I'm not here to escape. I'm here to harass. We're going to start a peace movement. This is Nonviolence USA. Yeah, the worry of it all. The Pentagon has made Kentucky into an armed camp. But one enemy that the military never built a defense against is hermits. How do you detect a hermit on a radar screen? No. Even the military, they'd feel uncomfortable attacking a hermitage. I know I mustn't enjoy this too much, but I do like changing things. And I even like moving the chairs around my little cinder block hideaway. See? And I sure would love to change the abbot while I'm busy changing the world. I like to challenge settled systems. But I feel now that I don't have much longer to live. I think of all the roads that I never walked, roads that are lost to me now. They're irretrievable except for my longing for them. I feel there's autumn in my bones and the chill of death in the air. I never found the peace that I was looking for. I've begun to think that it will elude me in the end. But maybe if I can bring peace to others, maybe that's enough. Sometimes you have to be willing to stand on the outside and be happy that some other people got what you wanted more desperately than you'd be willing to let on, and maybe that has something to do with Christ and goodness and human decency. And, you know, I wouldn't mind dying if it would stop the war in Vietnam. I'd give my life to stop it as a sacrifice and atonement. But what's one more death when so many have died already? I wouldn't mind dying at all if it would help defuse the monster bombs, and I wouldn't mind dying if, even if I myself never enjoyed a world in which peace was assured. It's such an ancient dream, it's a myth dream, I know. I wouldn't mind dying at all if such a world would come to pass. I've been surrounded by war for 50 years, and a whole bunch of pacifists are coming here this afternoon, and we haven't got enough chairs. Dorothy Day, she's excited about a Catholic peace movement. But somehow I have become the guru of the group, the Gandhi of Gethsemane. Hermits against H-bombs. Boy, that'd confuse them, wouldn't it? We're going to make life uncomfortable for all those who'd like to exterminate it. See, there are a lot of Catholics out there with hierarchical household names who are a little nervous about what I'm doing. They're anxious about hermits. Well, imagine that, being scared about people who are struggling for nonviolence. Well, I mean, the bishops for the bomb. That's a travesty. I mean, when Christ took the sword out of Peter's hand, he disarmed every Christian soldier. Christ did not come here to let the killing go on. And I mean, the same people, they demand capital punishment for the crime of homicide, but those same people applaud as virtuous those who slaughter thousands. Now, they say that I'm too political. They think that if I said my prayers well, they'd never hear from me. Well, they'd like that. But it's an irony. I mean, how do you shut up a monk who's made a vow of perpetual silence? How do you tell a hermit to be quiet? Gandhi, he said that you can't be holy in the 20th century unless you change the political order. And Christ, he took on the politics of Rome and Jerusalem. They wanted him to say his prayers. He said short ones and was back in the marketplace. So, you know, when you don't cause trouble in a world as troubled as today's, you're in trouble. So how can I sit still and meditate when 6 million Jews were exterminated? How can I be silent when my own countrymen nuclear bomb Japanese cities? And, you know, how can I pretend that I don't know when I've seen with my own eyes the hell hole we made out of Harlem? Now, I love the nation too much to applaud it when it destroys lives, and I believe in liberty and I believe in justice for all too ardently to put an American stamp of approval on atrocity and on genocide. So, I guess I'm gonna embarrass them. And I'll shame them. I'll paralyze them with guilt. My words gonna split atom bombs to pieces. I'm not gonna let a cardinal silence me when the gospel of Christ is on fire in me. If God made me a nut, or a zealot, or a lunatic, or a fanatic, so be it. But I'm gonna be what I have to be. And if God made me nutty, I'm gonna be the best damn nut this monastery's ever seen. You know, the more people have died in wars in this century than all the other wars previously combined. We've killed with a savagery in my lifetime that the history of the world never witnessed before. Well, it's gotta stop, you know. We gotta stop calling it virtue. I mean, maybe the world needs a nut, huh? To recognize the lunacy of it all. We killed till our arms ached. We killed so many, you know, we didn't have names for them, so then we started killing by numbers, and we killed so many women and so many children. We made the world an orphan, and now we're getting ready for a bigger war, huh? With better bombs. We can kill millions in minutes. Oh, God, give me the strength and the voice and the words and the courageous heart to do something for all those who are about to die and for all those who've died. Make me die instead of them. Lord, more than anything else in the world, I want peace. If not for me, at least for them. Dear Father Abbot, with this letter I wish to begin the process of my resignation from the monastery. I know you will be relieved. We have not been the best of friends, and I have not become the monk I might have been. What may surprise you even more is that I am grateful for you. There is a chaos in me, an anarchy that needed a strong hand to control it. I can't be sure all your motives were noble, but the end result helped me. You were often unreasonable, but so am I. At times I thought you were petty, but so am I. And at times I thought we provoked each other in ways we might have avoided. There are, of course, others to think of besides ourselves. There are the other monks. The other day you told me that they consider me a faithful monk and are often inspired by what I do. I'm grateful you told me that. I shall treasure those words. They are in my heart until the very end. But they, of course, create an obligation I shall disappoint them. Especially the younger monks I train, but they must know that I didn't train them to be my disciples. And of course, I worry about my readers and those that I have guided, but they must know that what I've written is the truth as I know it, and they must know that what I do now is another form of the truth. I've written 60 books in 20 years. I have been obsessed with writing, but without the writing, I don't think I would have stayed as long or grown as much. And without the writing, we might have been better friends, and the loss of that friendship may very well be the price we have paid for what each of us knew to be right. And of course, there is Margaret. I love her. But I don't resign because of her. Nor shall I marry her. I think I gave up long ago the capacity to be self-giving. With my books and my silences and my projects, I don't think there's any space left for anyone else permanently. There is a great sadness in my heart because of this, but it is better this way. If others knew of her, it might make their understanding of what I'm doing now too easy. It's not easy, but I do believe it's right. There were so many conflicting loyalties in my life, and she came in the middle of my commitments with her demand that I be more human. And she did bring me peace. But I know it would not last, and I could never bring her tranquility, so the issue's settled. Margaret will cry about it as I've wept about it, but the tears will be more merciful than the marriage would be. I know that you are harassed and attacked by other abbots and by Rome, by abbots and bishops and cardinals, and letters from angry Catholics because of my writings and my social protests and because of my visits to folk singers. And my visits with civil rights leaders, my anger at the war in Vietnam, my opposition to the arms race, my acceptance of optional celibacy, and my defense of Oriental religions. So it's better that I no longer burden this community with a hapless hermit who can't keep his mouth shut. I have to get away from everything and from everyone. I need to wander in the desert somewhere or become anonymous in the city. I have to give up everything once again without knowing whether what I burn will end in glory or in ashes. My faith is no longer a string of certitudes. My faith is a series of doubts which somehow never become denial. The Lord is there, ambiguously and assuredly. Faith may be no less certain for me because I attach conditions and I hesitate because I question and reconsider the whole process. In any case, I'm not settled, though. You may be more settled now that you're rid of me. Oh, someone once said that I'm a very clever person. That may be true, but I'm not very wise. There is a chaos in me, an anarchy that's almost self-destructive. I do things with my whole heart, and I don't do them reasonably or with moderation. And my whole heart went into this monastery. I shall not get it back. My life cannot be unbound from this monastery, and it should not be. Therefore, I leave with regrets, undeniably, with songs of gratitude for what was, and I confess a measure of relief. I shall sign this letter, Father Lewis. It is a name I used on none of my books, but it's a name that my brothers used when they wanted me to know that they and I were one. I leave Lewis behind, and it's Thomas Merton who goes forth. I shall miss Lewis, but I leave him here in the hopes that he may remind you of me, and that you would think of Thomas Merton, and that you would pray for him. Respectfully, Thomas. And so I die a monk after all. An answer to the great question. Well, it's fitting that it end this way, closer to Pearl Harbor than Gethsemane. Where am I anyway? The East Pearl. Pearl of great price, the Pacific, yes. I died like a criminal, electrocuted. Christ died like a criminal. My flesh burned as shock after shock hit me. I could smell the burning of my own body, and I die so far from home. Harbor, home, harbor, peace, harbor, mother, don't hold me, don't you be cold to me. Father, Abba, Abba, Father. Father Abbot, bring me peace, let me in. I want to be a monk, and I'm glad I never sent that letter. I'm glad I die a monk. Oh, God, take the pain, make peace in the world. Make the pain mean something more than this coldness I feel and the darkness that wants me to despair. And was I wrong to have written so well of myself and so poorly of others? Was I immature to have valued my life and disregarded others? Well, so many conflicting loyalties. There was too much to be loyal to. There was too much of this and too much of that and too many fidelities and not enough. I never did enough. I wrote 60 books and I didn't find the right words. I went into Asia and I went to Thailand and I never saw enough and I ran out of life before all those loyalties were satisfied and I never did enough. The road ran out and there was so much to do and there was no more time. There's no more time. Now the final minutes and are there no trains to take me home? Well, there are no trains to Pearl Harbor. Dad, paint me a bright picture. And we need a bright picture now. You know, it's getting dark. And no one's lighting any more lights. Yes, paint me a bright picture and take me with you when you go away to paint. You know, pain, paint, so much pain when you go away to paint. Mama, you put down that pen, don't write. Not right for you to write. You hold me. Don't you be cold to me. God. Oh, God, I loved you. Through it all, I loved you. You were the thread that held it all together, God. You held me when others wouldn't hold me, and I know I never lost you. I followed you from the West into the East, from Europe to America to Asia. You went into purgatory with me and guided me through the seven-story mountain and kept me company in Gethsemane. You were with me at all the train stations of my life, and you taught me to dream of paradise and of Pearl Harbor. You were the goal I grasped and lost, grasped and lost. But I never stopped reaching for you. And now the journey is done, and I'm in the harbor near the shore of safety. And it's so quiet. Lord, I trusted you every time I was lost. And I feel so lost now. I'm cold and I'm frightened. Not of you, but of my own inadequacy. I have no adequacy left. Lord, put Father Lewis and Thomas Merton together and take me home beyond Gethsemane. Peace.
Toilet.